Find free public outdoor shooting ranges on the Plinkster app. Download now.
Hi, I'm Brett, and I'm back home in Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, where I grew up. And my friend Adam Buck is going to give us a tour of his museum that's opening in June later this year. His family collects military vehicles, specifically from World War II. And so they have a huge collection. I've always enjoyed seeing it when it was at their home, but now they've built this beautiful new museum where they'll tell a story with those vehicles.
So they had to like cut a tree down or put up a bridge. It had all the tools they needed. Here's a jackhammer. There's nail guns and drills. There's even a two-man chainsaw on the other side. And it's probably about that long. And they're all air-powered. I mean, it's pretty aggressive stuff compared to like a DeWalt drill today.
Pretty cool.
We actually have three of these. And the Jeep was actually first designed by Bantam, a company from Butler, VA.
Really?
And they had the first design, and Ford, Willys, and Bantam all went to the U.S. government with their prototypes, and Bantam couldn't produce enough Jeeps to win the contract, so they actually ended up building trailers. So they got the short end of the stick. So Ford and Willys ended up making Jeep, and then Willys, after the war, went on to make civilian Jeeps, so I guess they made up the best. Sandblast everything. So just get everything down to bare metal, prime paint, rebuild everything that's mechanical. But sometimes you don't have to do all that. Sometimes you might find a low mileage Jeep that was well taken care of and maybe you just want to paint it.
Huh.
This was a pretty nice one to start with. It only has 13,000 miles on it.
What is this?
That's a field top that was put on. It's called a wire cutter.
Wire? Oh, just in case you're going through.
Well, the Germans, starting in Italy, they took note that a lot of GIs would drive the Jeep with the windshield down. So they would take thin wire, like piano wire, and they'd hang it from tree to tree across the road. If you're going down the road with the windshield down, you'd get decapitated. So they took scrap metal, the GIs did, and they just made pieces like this, put them to the front of the Jeep, and that cup of wire. That's a Sherman. 1945. And it runs, drives, fully restored. This one's got a 105 howitzer as its main gun.
Look how thick this metal is.
Good God.
Can imagine what this weighs.
That's considered a destructive device, and you have to have it registered with the ATF. So it's, you know, it's completely legal because we did all the paperwork and then they checked us out. And really, you know, we're not going to fire live rounds. It makes the vehicle obviously more complete, more valuable, cooler.
How many people can you fit inside?
It's a 5-man crew. I mean, you can put more people in there than that. Not the most comfortable thing.
I would put your right foot here and okay, so just make sure you're always holding on to something. Yeah, that moves, it's a machine gun.
Oh. One's back here.
I see.
But the rest are down below.
And how many rounds would you carry?
Probably about 50, 60. Off the top of my head, yeah.
Do you have the shells?
Yeah, we have some.
It's a tight fit in here.
Where do you put a spare tire on the tank?
We just put that one there just for looks.
Oh, I see.
Really, the only our stairs are just track locks. Because you can replace those, you know, one of those sooner than what they call a road wheel right there. And then you have your tools up here, all my tools, your axes or shovels. And actually what's kind of cool, this is a late war modification. Phone to talk to the crew. That is called an M4 high speed tracker. That is an artillery priming gun. It pulls large artillery like the 155 howitzer or the 90mm anti-aircraft gun or the 8-inch howitzer, one of those three guns. These trailers and trucks are used for recovering knocked out tanks, transporting tanks, and this whole truck came up from Texas, the same collector that had the Sherman.
Okay.
Oversized load the whole way. Yeah. I mean, just, sometimes you pay more in shipping than you do for the actual vehicle. 1944 Willys, never put into service, new at the end of the war, in the crate with 2,900 miles on it. This is even nicer than that one. That's a 1946 Willys civilian Jeep, the CJ2A. So that's what started it all, you know, with the civilian market. Willys took the Jeep, some cool differences. They put different headlights on, they put their name on the side, on the windshield frame, and they made a more user-friendly top, so you can actually put doors on the side, which are laying on my trailer right there. Canvas doors, you can take the back end off and make it into like a pickup truck, you can have a half cab. And then at the back, there's a tailgate. So you can use it as a car, or you can use it as a pickup truck. You could put a PTO on it and, you know, use it on a farm. You can put a plow behind it. In 1946, I think there were only two color options. Yeah, if I remember correctly, this is called Pasture Green. The other option was, I think it was called Harvest Tan. It had red wheels. Pretty sure.
And this one's been restored, or you found this one in the underground cell too?
I wish we did.
No, my dad and I restored this. So, this is an ignorant question, so I'll ask you. What is the